So I want to go ahead and continue now with Beowulf. In this particular talk, I want to do this now with special reference to the Siegfried mythos. Siegfried, as he's known in the Nibelungenlied, which is the late German work of the myth. He's known variously in Old Norse as Sigurd. That's what Tolkien calls him in his book on the myth of Sigurd and Gudrun. And Siegfirth, Siegfried, the suffix varies in varying locales. And whose father is Siegmund, who the suffix of whose name, as Tolkien points out, as we'll see, does not vary and is significant. What the Beowulf poet does here in this next passage is he takes the Siegmund-Siegfried myth, and apparently, as Tolkien points out, Siegfried was not yet known to him. He knew only of the version of an early version of the myth in which Siegmund does not have a son and is the one who slays the dragon, since it's well known that it's Sigurd or Siegfried who slays the dragon, not the father. But this seems to be an earlier version of the myth in which the Beowulf poet takes the myth, the Siegmund dragon slaying, and folds it into the Beowulf epic, and does so to make a point, as we'll see here. So we're on the second day here, Beowulf's second day with the Danes, and it says, at times the brave warriors spurred their bays, horses renowned for their speed and stamina, and raced each other where the track was suitable. And now and then one of Hrothgar's thanes, who brimmed with poetry and remembered lays, a man acquainted with ancient traditions of every kind, composed a new song in correct meter. Most skillfully, that man began to sing of Beowulf's feat, to weave words together and fluently to tell a fitting tale. And so now we already begin to see how a shop is already constructing together the myths associated with the deeds of a great warrior hero. He recounted all he knew of Siegmund, and the Old English pronunciation here of Siegmund is Siegmund, of Siegmund, the son of Wales, many a strange story about his exploits, his endurance, and his journeys to Earth's ends. Many an episode unknown or half-known to the sons of men, songs of feud and treachery, only Fitela knew of these things, had heard them from Siegmund, who liked to talk of this and that, for he and his nephew had been companions in countless battles. They slew many monsters with their swords. After his death, no little fame attached to Siegmund's name. When the courageous man had killed the dragon, guardian of the hoard, under the gray rock, the son of the prince braved that dangerous deed alone. Fitela was not with him. For all that, as fate had it, he impaled the wondrous serpent, pinned it to the rock face with his patterned sword, the dragon was slain. Through his own bravery, that warrior ensured that he could enjoy the treasure hoard at will. The son of Wales loaded it all onto a boat, stowed the shining treasure into the ship. The serpent burned in its own flames. Because of all his exploits, Siegmund, guardian of strong men, was the best known warrior in the world. then he proceeds to contrast him with Hermod, who was the disastrous Danish king prior to Shield Cheffing. So he's taken the myth, apparently an earlier version of it in which Siegmund, and I'm just going to pronounce it as Siegmund since it's easier to do, in which Siegmund is the slayer of the dragon. He's the son of Wals, this is the line of the Volsungs. The father of Siegmund in the Volsunga saga is Volsung. And there, Siegmund has a son by his sister Signy, who contrives a ruse to produce a son who will be of pure blood, a pure-blooded Volsung, by disguising herself and sleeping with her brother to produce Sinfjotli, who turns up here as the character Fitela, who is his nephew rather than his son. In the Volsunga saga, Sinfjotli is his son, and the son is bred simply and primarily for the purpose of taking vengeance on those who have wronged Siegmund. And various plots are contrived. The vengeance is takes place. King Siegair is killed, who is the man that Signy has been married to. His house is burned down. Flames and fire ensue. But Siegmund is the character who then marries another woman named Hjordis and produces Sigurd, the character of Sigurd with Hjordis, just as he also produces with another woman the character of Helgi Hundingsbane. Now, as Tolkien has pointed out, what Tolkien thinks has happened here in the Beowulf story is that the poet is only aware at this time in Old English of a version of the myth in which Siegmund is the dragon slayer, does not yet have a son, but he points out that there are references to the other material, the Burgundian material that has to do with Gunther, Gunnar, as he's variously named Gunnar, Guthiri. In Old English, he's Guthiri. Gunnar, Guthiri, And the whole myth cycle that's connected with Gunnar and Atli, who is Attila the Hun, which is a myth cycle of the Burgundians that comes to us based on historical wars between the Goths and the Huns that took place in the middle of the 5th century AD. So around 450 AD is what that material comes from. And what Tolkien thinks has happened is that the character of Sigmund has been duplicated. Very often, separate myths will be fused together simply by ascribing the hero of one myth to be the son of the hero of another myth. And he thinks that Siegmund was originally the dragon slayer. And he says that part of the proof of this is the fact that when you look at the suffix of Sigurd's name, it varies from place to place. In some cases, it's Siegfried, Sigurd, Siegfret. It has all these variants that are associated with it, but the suffix of Siegmund's name never changes. It's always the same, which leads Tolkien to suspect that it's the older version, that it was originally Siegmund. And he also thinks it's suspicious that the same sword is used. The sword Gram is used by both Siegmund and his son Sigurd, which suggests the possibility of a duplication and a continental myth cycle that later was fused together with the Burgundian myth cycle. Now, the Burgundian myth cycle has to do with Gunnar and Atli, and it has to do with historical materials. Briefly, though, before we get to that, we need to review the myth. So briefly, what happens after Siegmund fathers Sigurd? There is a gold hoard. This is known as Andvari's gold, and Sigurd's foster father, Regin, tells him the backstory of this gold hoard, Andvari's gold, which the gods one day, the Æsir, were out, the three of them, Votan, Loki, and Hrungnir, were out wandering and hunting one day when they encountered a character named Otter. And Otter was just that, an otter, who happened to be the brother of two brothers, Fafnir and Regin. Regin is Sigurd's foster father who is raising him. And they kill the otter, and they skin him, and they bring the skin. They come to the house of a man named Hreidmar looking for lodging. And Hreidmar says, "What have you got there?" And he says, "We just killed this otter." And he says, "Oh, that's my son. You owe me wergild for killing him. So I demand that you," he takes them hostage, and he says, "I demand that you fill this skin with gold. And it has to be complete." Well, they don't have the gold, so Loki has to go find it, and he finds it at the habitation of a dwarf who exists in the form of a fish but can change into a dwarf named Andvari, who has the gold. Loki takes it from him, but Andvari curses the gold, puts a curse on it, and says that whoever possesses the gold hoard will only encounter misfortune. Bad things will happen to him. Loki says, "Okay, fine, whatever," and takes the gold, and they give it as ransom for the gods, so they give it to Hreidmar, and so the gods get free. But now the gold hoard is in the possession of Hreidmar, the father, and Fafnir and Regin want it from him, Fafnir in particular. So Fafnir kills Hreidmar, the father, one night and steals the gold from him, but refuses to share it with his brother Regin, and instead banishes Regin, and will have nothing to do with him. And what happens to Fafnir, of course, is that he devolves into the dragon and becomes the great dragon Fafnir. So meanwhile, Sigurd has lost his father. Siegmund is dead. The mother is dead, and he has only this foster father, the smith, the brother Regin. Note there too that we have the gods, the Æsir, coming up against three brothers, Otter, Fafnir, and Regin, which is the motif of the three antagonists that we encounter. Beowulf goes up against three monsters, which is a basic structure of Indo-Aryan hero myths. Coming up against a three-headed monster with three brothers, very often is a typical characteristic of the mythos. And so Regin has raised Sigurd, and he wants him to kill his brother Fafnir to get the gold from him. And he can't do it himself, and he knows that only Sigurd can do it for him. So he raises him, and when he comes of age, he tells this backstory to him and says, "Go kill this dragon, and we'll make a special sword for you." He makes two swords, both of which fail, but Sigurd has inherited the broken pieces of his father's sword, Gram, the sword is called, and he gives it to Regin, and Regin fashions the sword perfectly. It cuts through the anvil, and he uses it to go and kill Fafnir. So he goes to kill Fafnir, but the way in which he kills Fafnir differs from the way in which the Beowulf poet says that Siegmund kills him. Sigurd digs a hole in the ground and lies down in the hole flat, and when the dragon passes over the hole, he reaches up and stabs him in the belly. In the myth as we have it in the Beowulf epic, though, the Beowulf poet has changed the circumstances of the myth to where Siegmund simply goes into a cave, pins the dragon to a wall with the sword, kills him, and the dragon burns itself up, and he takes the gold and loads it on a boat and leaves. that version of the myth is much more fits much more carefully the circumstances that are associated with Beowulf killing the dragon, who also goes into a cave and slays the dragon. And so either the poet has changed the myth to make it mirror and foreshadow Beowulf's slaying of the dragon, or this was simply how the myth existed circa 700 AD when the Beowulf poet was writing this. And to get back to the myth, though, Siegfried then has killed Fafnir. And when he does so, Regan then, who has been skulking about on the scene, shows up and demands that he have the gold, or at least a share in the gold. And he tells him to eat the heart of the dragon, and he does so, and he tastes the blood of the dragon. Once he tastes the blood, Siegfried can hear the birds and understand their language, and they advise him to kill Regan because Regan has plans to kill Siegfried to steal the gold from him. So he kills Regan and cuts off his head. So all three brothers are dead by this point. Otter has been slain long ago. Fafnir has been killed by Siegfried, and also his brother Regan has been beheaded by Siegfried, who now inherits the gold hoard. So he's got the gold hoard with him, and then he ascends the mountain where he has heard that a woman has been imprisoned by a circle of fire, and this is, of course, the Valkyrie Brynhild, whom her father Odin has condemned since she disagreed with him about the fate of a warrior and intervened incorrectly. She will no longer judge like a Norn in the fates of heroes, but she must instead be condemned to wed a man, but only a man with no fear, and only one man, namely Siegfried, who can break through the ring of fire to get to her. He does this. The two get together and fall in love and pledge each other's heart to one another, and Brynhild says, but you first have to get a kingdom to be with me. So he agrees, and he says, okay, that's fine. So he leaves, and he wanders to the kingdom of Heimer, and Heimer has married Brynhild's sister, Beckhild. So he knows of her. Brynhild is well known in this kingdom. And this is the kingdom of the Giukungs. We have King Giuki and his wife Grimhild, whose offspring are, once again, three sons and a daughter. In this case, the sons are Gunnar, Hogni, and Gudorm. And the daughter is a woman named Gudrun. So once again, we have the three sons and a daughter motif. Just as in Beowulf, we have with both the Geats and the Danes, three sons and a sister. In both cases, there's a direct mirroring effect that's going on there. And so Siegfried then marries Gudrun, largely because Grimhild knows of the gold hoard and wants to get it for her family. And she concocts a potion, which she gives then to Siegfried, which he drinks, and he forgets about Brynhild, forgets that he ever met her. So he has to put on the semblance of Gunnar. The mother wants Gunnar to marry Brynhild. But he has to put on the semblance of Gunnar in order to break through the ring of fire for him. And he dupes Brynhild into thinking that he's this person, Gunnar. And so she marries Gunnar. They exchange rings, and the marriage ceremony takes place. And so Gunnar and Gudrun, who are brother and sister, then Gunnar marries Siegfried. Gunnar marries Brynhild, and Siegfried marries Gudrun. So we have this very complicated interfamilial cross-hatching going on that leads to a kind of mesh or net of fate that draws Siegfried down. Brynhild finds out about the duping. Gudrun, one day when the two were bragging about their respective husbands, Gudrun says that her husband is greater. He's the one who went through the ring of fire, and here's the ring that you gave to him as proof. Brynhild realizes that she's been duped and decides that she wants vengeance on Siegfried. And so she convinces her husband, Gunnar, to have him killed. And so Gunnar advises with Hogni, and the two get together and decide their younger brother, Gudorm, who has not pledged any oaths, should be the one to do this deed. So they convince him to go and kill Siegfried, which he does. He surprises Siegfried in his sleep. He's lying in bed with Gudrun, in one version of the myth, and Gudorm kills him, but Siegfried kills him simultaneously, so the two kill each other and wipe each other out, which is one of the major Scandinavian myth motifs, just as big. Beowulf and the dragon, or Thor and the Midgard serpent, kill each other simultaneously. They wipe each other out. let's pause here for the next video.